Santa Maria Corredo, and I'm director of CCBD and professor at the School of Business at the University of Victoria. It is my privilege today to introduce Professor Timothy Mitchell as our 2012 distinguished speaker. Professor Mitchell is a renowned political economist from Columbia University. Over the last years at CCBD, we have been arguing for broadening the word economy and uncovering different practices of economic democracy that are happening here and elsewhere. With the challenges that climate change brings us, one of the questions we ask is how to transition to a different economy. In his latest book, Carbon Democracy, Mitchell explains how our dependence on oil has shaped our democratic and economic life. Changes, he suggests, demand not only innovation, but a real reassessment of the global economy foundations. As you see, Dr. Mitchell's work asks big questions. And in answering them, he reaches into fields such as history, anthropology, cultural studies, political theory, political geography, ecology, and science technology, to name just a few. And I have to say that I admire how he brings all those fields together into a rich and readable tapestry. Professor Mitchell received a first degree in history from Queen's College, Cambridge, and his PhD in politics at Princeton University. In 2008, after 25 years at New York University, Professor Mitchell joined Columbia University, where he is currently professor and chair of the Department of Middle Eastern, South Asian, and African Studies. His areas of research include the place of colonialism in the making of modernity, the material and technical politics of the Middle East, and the role of economics and other forms of expert knowledge in the government of collective life. Much of his current work is concerned with ways of thinking about politics that allow material and technical things more weight than they are given in conventional political theory. He's the author of the well-known book, Colonizing Egypt, which explores forms of reason, power, and knowledge that define the experience of modernity. The book is a classic and a staple in any university curriculum. Other books include Rule of Experts, Egyptian Politics and Modernity, The Property of Markets, and various essays on rethinking economy. We're honored to have Professor Mitchell here tonight to present Carbon Democracy, Energy, and Democratic Politics, based on his latest book, Carbon Democracy. Before I turn the podium to him, let me say that Lubik have kindly set a table outside for you to purchase a book, and I'm sure Professor Mitchell will be very glad to sign it. So, without further ado, let me welcome Professor Mitchell.
No, it's not saying
that. I'm the proud owner of this book. I know I've run out.
Thank you to Marie Toledo and to the Center for this invitation to be here to give a lecture. It's a real pleasure. This book, Carbon Democracy, examines the relationship between fossil fuels and democracy across the 20th century until today. A relationship that it describes, one could say, as follows. Coal created the possibility of modern mass democracy, and oil its limits. Much of the book explores the making of our carbon-based democracy, particularly in the early and middle decades of the 20th century. But I wrote about the past, including in particular the Middle East, the area in which I've written most of my scholarship, because I wanted to understand the contemporary limits of democracy today. After the terrorist attacks of 9/11 in New York and Washington, one of those limits was very widely discussed. A distinctive feature of the Middle East, it was said, was the region's lack of democracy. And many people thought that lack had something to do with oil. Countries that depend upon petroleum resources for large parts of their earnings from exports apparently tend to be less democratic. The uprisings that spread across the Arab world over the last year and a half appear to confirm this relationship between large oil earnings and the difficulty of mounting claims to a more democratic and egalitarian life. Drawing a map of the Middle East and color-coding the countries by oil revenues, you need three colors, those with a lot of oil, those with none, and those with a small amount and mostly declining. That map would have given you a map of the Arab Spring. It would have been the last group when the revolts broke out. Now, those who write about this question of the oil curse, as it's sometimes called, usually have little to say about the nature of oil, how it's produced, distributed, how we use it. They discuss not the oil, but the oil money, the income that accrues after petroleum is converted into government revenue and private wealth. The explanations have nothing to do with the ways in which oil is extracted, processed, piped, shipped, and consumed, the powers of oil as a concentrated source of energy, or the apparatus that turns this fuel into forms of affluence and power. They treat the oil curse as an affliction only of the governments that depend on its income, not of the processes by which a wider world obtains the energy that drives its material and technical life. Initially, like everyone else, I thought of oil as one thing and democracy as another, and I wanted to make a better sense of why one seemed to be bad for the other. But after following how the oil industry was built, especially, as I say, in the Middle East, history in the Middle East, as I traced the ways in which people had explored for oil, built pipelines and terminals, transformed petroleum into forms of heat energy and transportation, converted the income from those processes into profits, sought ways to circulate and govern those flows of money, and built political worlds around the government of a new object that no one knew to exist before the 1940s, called the economy, which, like the flow of oil, seemed capable of infinite expansion. As I followed all these ideas, it became increasingly clear that carbon energy and modern democratic politics were tied intricately together. Rather than a study of democracy and oil, it became a book about, if you like, democracy as oil, as a form of politics whose mechanisms, as they've taken shape on multiple levels, involve the processes of producing and using carbon energy. When studies of oil and democracy confine their attention to the problem of oil and money, the oil curse, the income from oil and its corrupting powers, rather than starting with the process through which oil is produced and distributed, they are unconsciously imitating the way energy networks were first built. In 1914, to give you one example, when Shell began producing oil in Venezuela, the country's dictator, General Gomez, asked the company to build its refinery offshore on the Dutch island of Curaçao. He wanted the money from oil, but he didn't want the large concentrations of workers and accompanying labor demands that a refinery would bring. In other words, if oil appeared to affect the producer states largely after its transformation into flows of money, that appearance, as this as an example shows, was produced in the policing of refineries, the building of pipelines, the negotiation of royalties, and other arrangements that from the start, in their effort to evade the demands of an organized labor force, were concerned with the questions of carbon demography. The transformation of oil into large and unaccountable government incomes, the oil curse, is not a cause of the problem of democracy in oil, but the outcome of a particular way of engineering political relations out of flows of energy. So one can't just write about the oil-producing states. The leading industrialized countries are also all oil states. A few, the US, Canada, until recently the UK, are large oil producers themselves. Here in British Columbia, of course, an oil and gas pipeline is at the center of current politics in ways that perhaps would be interesting to discuss after the end of my talk. A few are large oil producers themselves, but all industrial countries are oil states in another sense. Without the energy they derive from oil, their current forms of political and economic life would not exist. We have developed ways of eating, traveling, housing ourselves, consuming other goods and services that require very large amounts of energy from oil and other fossil fuels. These ways of life are not sustainable, and they now face the twin crises that will end them. On the one hand, new discoveries of oil are unable to keep pace with the exhaustion of existing supplies. The flow of oil from existing fields is declining so fast, oil companies have to bring online 3 to 4 million barrels per day of new production every year just to stay in place, just to keep up. Now that's the equivalent of having to discover and develop a new Saudi Arabia every 3 to 4 years. Add to that, meanwhile, that Saudi Arabia itself has trouble maintaining its current output and also uses more oil at home every year than for many other large producers, in Saudi Arabia's case in particular for air conditioning or for desalination. And that some estimates suggest that by 2030, 2.5 decades or so from now, Saudi Arabia would have become a net importer of oil. So besides the new Saudi Arabia's needed every 3 or 4 years, we're even going to need to replace the original one very soon. Now, although estimating reserves of fossil fuels is a political technical process involving rival methods of calculation, it does seem that we're about to enter an era of declining supplies. The Earth's store of fossil fuels, of course, won't be exhausted as coal and oil become more scarce or the difficulty and cost of extracting them increases. The cost and expenditure of energy that extraction requires will bring the era of fossil fuels to an end with consequences we cannot know. This will happen in a remarkably short period. More than half the oil consumed in the 150 years between the 1860s when the modern petroleum industry began and today has been burned just in the 3 decades since the early 1980s. From the perspective of human history, the era of fossil fuels now appears as a remarkably brief interlude. The second crisis is that in using up these sources of energy, as the US President's Science Advisory Committee warned half a century ago, in 1965, humankind has been, quote, unwittingly conducting a vast geophysical experiment, moving stores of carbon from coal mines and oil wells up into the atmosphere. The experiment proceeded much more rapidly than the science advisors in the 1960s expected. Levels of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere have now increased by 40% since the start of the industrial age, with half that increase happening as with the production of oil in the last 3 decades alone. The consequent changes in the Earth's climate threaten to become not just deleterious from the human point of view, as the 1965 report warned might be the case, but catastrophic on a planetary scale. So allowed to limit that oil represents for democracy, one could say, is that the political machinery that emerged to govern the age of fossil fuels and emerged in close relationship, as I will show, with those forms of energy, seems to be incapable of addressing the events that will end it. Thinking about the possibility of democracy in relation to energy doesn't mean tracing political outcomes back to the forms of energy that determine them, as though the powers of carbon were transmitted unchanged from the oil well or coal face to the hands of those who control the state. The carbon itself must be transformed, beginning with the work done by those who bring it out of the ground. The transformations involve establishing connections, building alliances, connections and alliances that don't respect any divide between the material world and the ideal world of politics, between the economic and the political, between the natural and the social, between human and non-human, between violence and the ways in which we understand them. The connections make it possible to translate one form of power into another. Understanding how fossil fuels enabled or restricted democratic claims requires tracing how these connections are built, the vulnerabilities and opportunities they create, and the narrow points of passage where control is particularly effective. Political possibilities were opened up or narrowed down by different ways of organizing the flow of concentration of energy, and these possibilities were enhanced or limited by arrangements of finance, of expertise, of consumption, and of violence that were assembled in relation to the distribution and control of energy. Like energy from fossil fuels, mass democratic politics is a recent phenomenon. The development of the two kinds of power has been interwoven from the start. I want to briefly outline the ways they were co-assembled, because I think making sense of this history can help us think in different ways about the present. And I'm going to start with the rise with coal and the rise of mass political parties, mass politics in Europe and America at the end of the 19th century and the beginning of the 20th. Now, of course, it's long been understood that the rise of coal, made possible by the use of steam power to access seams of carbon deep underground, allowed the development of large-scale manufacturing in the modern city, and out of mines and factories and urban life emerged the forces that struggled for democracy. But these political forces have usually been thought of very one-sidedly as social forces, social movements, gathering in workplaces, labor unions, political clubs, etc. People forged a political consciousness with which they fought for more egalitarian and democratic collective lives. The account is one-sided because it leaves out the equipment with which this political agency was assembled and ignores the technical vulnerability to which oligarchic forms of rule for many decades were then exposed. The socio-technical world built with the vast new energy from coal were vulnerable not just in a general way to do with new forms of political consciousness or new ways of people collecting together in social movements, but in a more specific way. And it was the movement of concentrated stores of carbon energy that provided the means for assembling these more effective political challenges to oligarchy. Large stores of high-quality coal were discovered and developed in relatively few sites, and most of the world's industrial regions were built adjacent to these supplies of coal. The development of steam transport, whose original function was to serve coal mining, which in turn was fueled by coal, facilitated the growth of these new supplies of energy. By the end of the 19th century, industrialized regions had built specialized networks that moved concentrated carbon stores from the underground coal face to the surface, and then on railways, to ports, to cities, and to sites of manufacturing and the generation of electrical power. Contrast this with earlier sources of energy: firewood, animal power, water mills, food crops, even human labor, all of which were based, if you like, on solar power. Converting solar radiation required very large areas of land set aside for woodland or as pasture, for cultivation, and as rivers. Energy was very widely available, but very thinly distributed. It was laborious to harness, and difficult to widely interrupt its supply because of its dispersed nature. With the switch to coal, vastly greater quantities of energy now flowed along very narrow channels. Large numbers of workers had to be concentrated at the junctions where these channels met or branched. Their position and concentration at those points gave them, at certain moments, a very new kind of political power. The power derived not just from the organizations they formed, the consciousness they began to share, or the political alliances they built, but from the extraordinary concentrations of carbon energy whose flow they could now slow, divert, or cut off. Coal miners played the leading role in contesting working regimes and the powers of employers in the labor activism and political mobilization of industrialized areas of the 1880s onwards. The unrest was concentrated not in manufacturing, but in the interconnected industries of coal mining, railways, dock workers, and shipping. In Great Britain, for example, the Great Unrest, as it was known, on the eve of World War I, typified the threat of a new kind of action, the new political act known as the General Strike, in which a triple alliance, as it was called, mine workers, dockers, and railwaymen exercised the power to shut down energy nodes. The dispersed energy systems of the old solar radiation had never allowed groups of workers this kind of power. The strikes were not always successful, but the new vulnerability experienced by the owners of mines, railways, and docks in Europe, in the United States, and Canada, together with steel mills and other large manufacturing enterprises dependent on coal, had its effect. For the period of a few decades, either side of World War I, labor movements could threaten a country's energy networks and thereby bring the productive life of an entire country to a halt. This threat impelled the oligarchs of the old liberal order into accepting the forms of welfare democracy and universal suffrage that would weaken working class mobilization. Let me jump to the end of World War II, when this relationship between oil and between energy and democracy, coal and democracy, began to change. Right after World War II, in 1945, oil workers at a refinery in Michigan launched a strike which soon spread across the entire American oil industry, and from there into automobile and other manufacturing, becoming the largest movement of labor protest in US history. In response, corporate America developed a new model of democratic politics, finally accepting on the one hand the right of workers to collective action, but limiting the role of unions to bargaining over pay and working conditions, which the owners agreed to improve only in exchange for increases in productivity. Workers would have no democratic role in governing the workplace, and there would be no wider redistribution of wealth, no turn to cooperative or other modes of sharing ownership. US planners wanted to export this corporate model of politics to Europe, where at the same time, after the Second World War, coal miners and their allies were fighting for a different democracy, one based on building universal health care and other social rights, and on a more cooperative management and ownership of industry. The coal miners, with their control of energy supplies, were leading this battle. Using the Marshall Plan, Washington responded with a new mechanism to defeat them: the conversion of Europe's energy system from one based on coal to one based predominantly on oil, a conversion that was also happening in the US at the same time, and that's why it was at that point in 1948 that the US, for the first time, became an importer of oil. Scarce supplies of steel and construction equipment were shipped from the US to the Persian Gulf to build a pipeline from eastern Saudi Arabia to the Mediterranean to enable a rapid increase in oil supplies to Europe. Europe would use the oil, along with the integration of energy supplies from building what became the European Union, another aspect of Marshall Plan thinking for Europe, in order to weaken the left. The diversion of scarce US steel and the Marshall Plan funds for this purpose, this conversion of Europe from coal to oil, was justified in part by the need to undermine the political power of Europe's coal mines. So what was different about petroleum? Like coal, it gave workers new kinds of power. However, the material qualities and physical locations of oil made things different. Since it comes to the surface, driven, initially at least, by underground pressure, oil required a smaller workforce than coal in relation to the quantity of energy produced. The workers, moreover, remained on the surface and therefore under continuous supervision and surveillance. Since the carbon occurs mostly in liquid form, pumping stations and pipelines could replace railways as the main means for transporting energy from the site of production to the places where it was used or shipped abroad. Pipelines were vulnerable, as I'll mention in a moment, but not as easy to incapacitate through strike actions as were the railways that carried coal. For similar reasons, oil could be easily shipped in large quantities across oceans, whereas historically very little coal crossed oceans. Compared to moving coal by rail, moving oil by sea eliminated the labor of coal heavers and stokers, and thus the power of organized workers to withdraw their labor from a critical point in the energy system. Ocean shipping operated, unlike railways, beyond the territorial spaces governed by the labor regulations and democratic rights won in the era of widespread coal and railway strikes. In fact, shipping companies could escape the regulation of labor laws altogether, as well as the payment of taxes, by resorting to so-called flags of convenience, removing whatever limited power of labor organizing there might have been left. The switch from coal, both in US and Europe, to oil, particularly oil from the Middle East, can be thought of as a kind of outsourcing of production, long before the outsourcing of manufacturing that was to happen a generation later, in the beginning of the 60s and on through the 70s. The outsourcing of energy production dates much more from the 1940s. Unlike railways, then, ocean shipping was not constrained by the need to run on a network of purpose-built tracks. Oil tankers frequently left port without knowing their final destination. They would steam to a waypoint and then receive a destination determined by the level of demand in different world regions. This flexibility carried risks. In fact, it was the cause of the world's first giant oil spill, the Torrey Canyon disaster off the coast of Cornwall, southwest England, in 1967. The tanker had no chance of the local coastline because it had set off, not knowing what part of the world it was destined to carry the oil to. But the flexibility at the same time further weakened the powers of the local forces that tried to control sites of energy production. So if a labor strike, for example, in the Middle East, or the nationalization of an oil industry because labor demands in a colonial context or recently decolonized context could quickly be translated into nationalist demands for state ownership of the industry. If the strike or nationalization affected production in one site, in one place in the world, the famous Iranian nationalization in 1951, for example, oil tankers could be quickly rerouted to supply oil from alternative sites. Now, these changes in the way forms of fossil energy were extracted, transported, and used made energy networks less vulnerable to the political claims of those whose labor now kept them running. At the same time, the fluidity and flexibility of oil presented new problems for those who owned or managed the production sites and distribution networks. It was no longer sufficient, as with coal, to control production and distribution in one particular region if you wanted to make very large profits. Since oil could easily move from one continent to another, petroleum companies, unlike coal companies, were always vulnerable to the arrival of cheaper oil from elsewhere. This vulnerability, seldom recognized, in the history of the oil industry, set further limits to the democratizing potential of petroleum. Market competition, of course, destroyed profits, the profits of oil companies, ruined them. So it had to be prevented at all costs. The difficulty of transporting coal across oceans meant that coal producers faced competition only within their own region, which could be regulated with local production cartels. Oil companies faced similar threats, similar risk of competition, but on a transoceanic scale. New devices were needed to limit the production and distribution of energy, including government quotas in the United States, protracted efforts from the early 20th century through to the 1950s and beyond to limit and prevent the development of a local oil industry in the Middle East, and cartel arrangements to govern the worldwide distribution and marketing of oil. These techniques and control shaped the development of what became the transnational oil corporation, the world's largest companies, which emerged not because companies like to get big and naturally do so, because this was the effective long-distance machinery for maintaining limits to the supply of oil and dealing with this constant threat of competition. Much of the history of oil in the 20th century, so different from the last decade, was how to maintain a system of scarcity, limit its supply. And one can't understand the history of the Middle East in the 20th century without realizing that fact. After the Second World War, when the risk was that the Middle East was indeed going to develop as a major oil production region, something that had been successfully prevented by the international oil companies in the first half of the century from when oil was discovered up until about 1945. After 1945, there were new devices for the production, this production and maintenance of scarcity. Let me mention two important techniques for transforming this period of post-war carbon energy abundance, as it risked being, into a system of limited and restricted and therefore highly profitable supplies. The first technique to mention was the new apparatus of peacetime national security, as it came to be known, particularly in the United States, which one might summarize as a system where Saudi Arabia's collaboration, the key collaboration of Saudi Arabia, Iraq before that, but Saudi Arabia later, in restricting the flow of oil and therefore maintaining a high price, was organized as though it were a system for protecting the oil against others with extraordinary military expenditures involved in that system. The second system of scarcity involved the rapid construction of lifestyles in the United States in particular, organized around extraordinary levels of energy consumption. In January 1948, James Forrestal, who was America's first Secretary of Defense, discussed with the president of Mobil Oil how, unless we had access to Middle East oil, quoting, American motor car companies will have to design a four-cylinder motor car sometime within the next 5 years. That was the threat. In the following years, of course, the US car companies helped out by replacing the standard six-cylinder engines with the new V8s as the dream of every middle-class family. The overweight and badly engineered American cars later lost out to better-built imports, but in the meantime, they helped engineer something much larger, Suburbia. And in general, carbon-heavy forms of middle-class American life that, combined with new political arrangements in the Middle East, would help the oil companies keep oil scarce enough to allow their profits to thrive. Now, if the ability of organized workers to disrupt the networks and known points of a coal-based energy system shaped the kinds of mass politics that had emerged, or in some cases just threatened to emerge in the first half of the 20th century, this post-war reorganization of fossil fuel networks altered, if you like, the energetics of democracy. The points of vulnerability where movements could organize and apply pressure, had now been extended to include a series of oil wells, pipelines, refineries, railways, docks, and shipping lanes across the Middle East. But the details of how the struggles there unfolded are worth recalling. Iraq was the most important battlefield, even from the 1930s and again in the 1950s, for it had among the region's largest reserves of oil, but was actually the place where the international oil companies worked hardest to impede the expansion of supplies. They delayed the building of pipelines, they deliberately drilled shallow wells, plugging those that unexpectedly produced oil, and keeping secret throughout the 1960s the scale of the country's resources. Britain had reoccupied the country in 1941, less than a decade after granting the country nominal independence after the original British occupation during the First World War. Post-war protests after the Second World War culminated in the popular uprising and student and worker strikes of 1948. The Communist Party of Iraq, one of the best organized political movements in the entire Middle East, its demands included, quote, the evacuation of the British troops, the unshackling of democratic freedoms, and the provision of decent bread to the people. The leading historian of Iraq in that period, the Palestinian scholar Hamad Al-Khartou, notes that the party, quote, had concentrated the weight of its force in the colossal enterprises that were most vital to the country, unquote. The railways, the port of Basra, and of course the oil fields. This focus on the most vulnerable points in the technical structures of a petroleum-based system of production, reminiscent, of course, of what had happened in the coal industries of Europe, Al-Khartou says, constituted the key to its basic, to the party's basic strategy. In the railways, the party organized most of its resources at, quote, the most fundamental point in the entire system, the railway workshops at Shoshina, where the main stores and all repair and maintenance work were concentrated. Quote, stoppage of activity in this place for 10 to 15 days would have brought the movement of trains in the whole of Iraq to a complete standstill, unquote. In the British-controlled oil field up in the north, the party focused its activities at an even more vital site. Quote, the point of bifurcation of the Kirkuk-Haifa and the Kirkuk-Tripoli pipelines. Pipelines that went on one hand to Lebanon, on the other hand to the coast of Palestine. This point of bifurcation was the K3 pumping station near the town of Haditha. A strike by oil workers in June of 1946, demanding the right to a union, to sickness and disability insurance, and a pension, was crushed by force, with 10 workers killed and 27 injured. During the 1948 uprising, however, the oil workers succeeded in shutting down the K3 station. Since the pumping station supplied the gasoline for other pumping stations, the union posted guard to ensure that not even a pint of gasoline, they said, should get out. The stoppage lasted 2 weeks until the company surrounded the site with machine guns and armored cars and cut off supplies of food. Unable to risk an armed confrontation, the strikers decided instead to march on Baghdad, 249 kilometers away. After 3 days of marching and increasing support from people along the way, they entered Fallujah, the site of a more recent confrontation between US and Iraqi forces. They entered Fallujah and, quote, fell into a police trap. The oil workers were captured, sent back to K3, and the strike leaders, off to prison. The other end of this Kirkuk-Haifa pipeline in Palestine provided another site of struggle. In the 1936-39 Palestine revolt, the most sustained anti-colonial uprising against the British in the Middle East, a major target of the insurgency was the recently completed pipeline from Iraq. Initial efforts to weaken the British in August of 1936 by organizing a strike at the oil refinery in Haifa and at the port, the railway, and the public works department were defeated when the British brought in Royal Navy engineers to run the trains and Jewish workers from the Jewish settlements to run the port and the refinery. The pipeline, however, was more vulnerable. Palestinian forces destroyed it for the first time in the on the 15th of July 1936 and blew it up on 10 other occasions. Unable to protect the pipe, the British created a force of armed Jewish settlers to assist with its defence, along with the protection of the Haifa-Linde railway line. This British officer force became the nucleus of the Zionist army that seized control of Palestine and created the State of Israel in 1948. It was events such as these that the post-war relationship between oil and democracy was being engineered. The book, Carbon Democracy, follows several other sets of connections between fossil fuels and 20th century democracy, and in other ways ties the history of our democracy to the history of oil and the history of the Middle East. These include, for example, the arrangements forged at Bretton Woods that regulated the creation of the IMF and the World Bank, that regulated the value of the US dollar through the movement of oil as a means of limiting the forms of private financial speculation that had destroyed pre-war democracy. It was well understood in 1945 that the unregulated international movement of finance was something destructive of democracy. It was the US Secretary of Treasury who, at the opening of the conference for the founding of the Bretton Woods Institution, said we have to find a way to drive the money lenders out of the temple of international finance, an insight into the anti-democratic nature of financial speculation that was lost, of course, a little while later. The arrangements also included the relationship between the rise of oil and the development of new forms of economic expertise, as I trace in several chapters of the book. A relationship organized around an object that came to be called for the first time the economy. The mission of this center, of course, is to explore and to help formulate new forms of economy based on cooperation and community. And I think one of the things this requires is that we understand the history, the very strange and very recent history of our current mainstream conception of the economy, and realizing how astonishingly recent it is as an idea. No economist before the 1930s believed in or wrote about the existence of something called the economy. Like 20th century mass democracy, 20th century economic expertise, as I show in the book, developed in a specific relationship to the hydrocarbon point, the hydrocarbon age. The concept of the economy is inseparable, I argue, from a particular relationship to and use of carbon energy. The economy, this new thing, was conceived in a particular way. It wasn't the total of the nation's wealth, something that had been proven almost impossible to calculate. It was imagined and measured rather simply as the phenomenon of United banknotes changing hands. Even if it's the same money, every time it changes hands in particular ways, it could be measured as part of the economy. So the old problem of trying to count total wealth and avoid double counting all disappeared. The economy was the sum of those monetary transactions. This reconceptualization helped define what became the new feature of this new object, the economy. It was something that could expand infinitely without ever getting physically bigger. Older ways of thinking about wealth were based upon physical processes that suggested limits to growth, the expansion of cities and factories, the colonial enlargement of territory, the accumulation of gold reserves, the growth of population, the absorption of migrants, the exploitation of new mineral reserves, increasing volumes of trade and commodities. All these older ways of imagining wealth were spatial and material processes that appeared to have clear physical limits. In fact, by the 1930s, many of those limits seemed to be approaching. Population growth in the West was leveling off. The colonial expansion of the US and the European imperial powers had ended and was threatened with reversal. Coal mines were being exhausted, and agriculture and industry were facing gluts of overproduction. The economy, on the other hand, measured by the new calculative devices of national income accounting, expressed in terms of the new figure of the GDP, GNP as it was then.
This was something that had no obvious limit.
National income, GDP, was a measure not of the accumulation of wealth, but, if you like, of the speed and frequency with which paper money changed hands and later electronic money. It could grow, it seemed, without any problem of physical or territorial limits. Oil contributed to the making of the economy as an object that could appear to grow without limit in specific ways that I explore in the book. Let me mention two of them. First, oil declined continuously in price in real terms. So the cost of using energy did not appear to represent a limit to growth. That's in decline roughly from the 1920s till around 1970, when adjusted for inflation. Second, thanks to its relative abundance and the ease of shipping it across oceans, oil could be treated as something inexhaustible. Its cost, in other words, included no calculation for the exhaustion of reserves. The growth of the economy, measured in terms of GDP, had therefore no need to take account of the depletion of energy resources. Moreover, the costs of air pollution, environmental disaster, climate change, and other negative consequences of using fossil fuels were not deducted from the measurement of GDP. Since the measurement of the economy made no distinction between beneficial and harmful costs, increased expenditure on the damage caused by fossil fuels appeared as an addition rather than an impediment to growth. In all these ways, the availability and supply of oil contributed to the shaping of this thing called the economy and its growth as the new object of mid-20th century politics. The oil wells and pipelines of the Middle East and the political arrangements that were built with them helped make possible the idea of the Keynesian economy and the forms of democracy, about which one could say more, in which it came to play a central part. Finally, one could briefly, in a couple of minutes I have remaining, follow the emergence of a new partner to the oil democracy nexus, particularly as one got towards the latter part of the 20th century. As oil revenues enabled Iran and later Saudi Arabia and other Gulf states to accumulate very large reserves of dollars in the 60s and into the 70s, U.S. banking and manufacturing needed ways to recycle those funds, those accumulations of petrol dollars, bring them back to the U.S. There was no way that could be done through ordinary consumer or capital purchases by the oil-producing nations of the Middle East. Those were insufficient because there's no way of consuming or building things fast enough to create demand for more. The solution was to consume weapons. Arms are useful in these kinds of situations because they're useless. You don't buy them to use them up, so you can always buy more. And a small object, like, say, a fighter jet, even then could cost tens of millions of dollars. An improvised speech by Richard Nixon on a visit to Southeast Asia, reiterating a long-standing program to arm local dictatorships, was transformed by policy groups in the US into something called the Nixon Doctrine in order to create the apparatus of justification for vast increases in arms sales. And university experts in security did the rest of the work needed to explain and justify this new system. US and other Western arms industries and related construction and consulting and banking interests came to depend on the new flows of oil and finances that were then consolidated by the crisis of 1973-74 that was part of that reorientation. These flows now required new levels of militarism, and indeed what became a US policy of prolonging and exacerbating local conflicts in the Middle East, and an increasingly disjunctive relationship with what you could call Salafist forms of Islam, particularly in places like Saudi Arabia, a politics whose consequences we're still living with in various ways today. I've tried to understand then this question of oil and democracy by following the oil itself, not because the material properties or strategic necessity of oil determine everything else. On the contrary, as I suggested, a lot of hard work went into reducing America's strategic dependence on the control of Middle Eastern oil, starting with all those V8 engines. But because in the building of a connected world of pipelines and pumping stations, refineries and shipping routes, road systems and automobile cultures, weapon experts and militarism, one discovers how a peculiar set of relations was engineered among oil, violence, finance, and expertise. The inclinations were quite different from those of the Coal Age. If the emergence of the mass politics of the early 20th century, out of which certain sites and episodes of welfare democracy on a new scale were achieved, if those should be understood in relation to coal, the limits and sometimes the openings of contemporary democratic politics, including those of the Arab Spring, must be followed, I think, in relationship to oil. And the possibilities of more democratic futures, both in that region of the world and here, in turn, I think, depends on the political tools with which we address the passing of the era of fossil fuel. The question, one might think, is not one of ending our dependency on oil, that's going to happen inevitably anyway, but of creating new kinds of dependency, both in the Arab world and here in North America. The question is one of how we compel the oligarchs who seek our consent to their rule to depend once again on the ordinary lives of most people to reproduce their own privilege and wealth. Thank you very much.